A year of Taliban rule in Afghanistan and the country is on its knees. UN experts have highlighted extrajudicial killings, kidnapping and staggering repression of women and girls. All this and the fastest meltdown of a country's economy in modern times, with millions at risk of hunger and starvation. My guest this week is Hasina Safi, former minister in the last Afghan government swept aside by the Taliban. She fled in the chaos and panic of the takeover, and she joins me in London as a refugee. Does she feel her country was betrayed by the West?
It was a decision of the international community. They came together, they left together. Now, where does Afghanistan stand?
Despite all the human rights abuses, is there any alternative to engaging with the Taliban? Should the international community recognize them and release the country's frozen funds? What would it take for her to consider going home? Hasina Safi, welcome to Conflict Zone.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
When you look back at the fear and terror that gripped Kabul last August last year, when you escaped, what images come back to you from that time?
Uncertainty, horror, unexpected issues, people without any vision, without any assurity, confused, fear, noises of guns, children crying, mothers carrying out their children, people lying on the roads close to the airport.
Unforgettable scenes.
Very unforgettable. I think never. Never. Even now when I imagine it, I become shocked for a very little time, and I think how hard human beings can be, how tough to survive through that kind of a time.
Up until the last minute, you didn't know whether you were going to survive, did you?
No.
Did you think you might die there at the airport in the chaos?
I did. In fact, at the beginning, I was expecting what we were hearing, that things have changed. So that is why I did not decide to leave on 15th of August.
When you say things have changed, what things? That the Taliban were different from
That's what we have been hearing. That's what we have been hearing, that Taliban have changed.
And that was nonsense.
Unfortunately, they did not only change, not only had changed, but they had become far, far different and inconsiderate than before.
Over the last year, the UN has documented persistent allegations of extrajudicial killings, disappearances, arbitrary detention, torture by the Taliban. Are they, in fact, more brutal and more cruel than they used to be?
I think they are. They are due to the analysis and due to the reports, due to the communication that I have from the women, more specifically.
It's the women who have been targeted most seriously. As the UN Human Rights Office put it recently, nowhere else in the world has there been as widespread, systematic and all-encompassing an attack on the rights of women and girls. Every aspect of their life is being restricted under the guise of morality. You said last year, Afghan women will fight for their country until the last drop of blood. How do they fight that?
That's what I say.
How do they fight that treatment from the Taliban?
They fight like the way today you see me in front of yourself talking about it. They fight like the way they are presently with the closed schools giving hope to the girls who are in the secondary school.
Secret schools.
Secret schools. They are fighting with the writings which they are doing through communication with their allies like us. They fight through still taking the courage and knowing that they will be killed, they will be damaged, they will be hurt, standing for demonstrations. They are really fighting it, and I am sure we will fight it. Again, once again, we will all fight it till the last drop of our blood.
Five separate US administrations failed to defeat the Taliban militarily on the battlefield or change their ideology. What makes you think that you can do any better than that?
I think no one tried ever to know the reality on the ground and to really put a very clear framework of what is Taliban's definition of Islam, what is Taliban's vision for women. Are the Afghan women the only women in Islamic society? No. So they can really compare with the other Islamic countries and see. Today, the countries in our region are announcing their female pilots, whereas in Afghanistan, in the last 20 years, we had all those initiatives which today some of the countries are announcing as an achievement being an Islamic country.
But is any of that going to make a difference to the Taliban? Is that going to change their behavior?
I think Taliban have to consider again the real vision and definition of Islam. It's not what they say, but it's what in reality the definition of Islam is. And once they consider that, definitely it has to change. I will not say they will change. It has to change. They must change that.
We've been seeing reports that maybe in their ranks, people are not in agreement with the leadership about, particularly about girls and education, secondary schools for girls. A lot of them would like to see girls studying in secondary schools. Do you believe that there are different opinions within the movement, within the Taliban movement?
Totally agree. Because just last week we heard that in one of the provinces, in Khost, the people have stood and they had urged to open schools. And they also, in communication with the directorate, opened the school. But again, there was a command for them to close the schools. So there is a difference of opinion within the different groups. It's not only on this. Within different structures, definitions, and ideas, they are not at a status where they define their structure at one level.
Do you feel betrayed by the West, by America?
It was rather a hasty decision. Things could have changed far better if it would have been considerate, thoughtful, and very seriously and cautiously thought about how the people would be least harmed from this decision. The international community had been inconsiderate in the decision that they took with a hasty departure, a very hasty departure.
But didn't you know when the deal was signed? Because the deal that Donald Trump signed with the Taliban didn't contain any guarantees of rights for the Afghan people, did it? In fact, the whole deal was negotiated over your head, wasn't it?
Exactly. No one was aware of what the deal was. And that is why the question comes that who is responsible for that? Because as a peace-building person, as a peace-building student, I think all the relevant stakeholders have to be involved when a peace deal is made. And it was not the case in Afghanistan.
You heard America's reasons for leaving. The US and its allies gave you 20 years, the lives of their soldiers they gave you, their know-how, their skills, schooling for girls, a rights-based system that has now been trashed by the Taliban. Isn't it true that the West gave you a big chance? Could you have made more of that chance in the 20 years that they were there?
I think it was not only Afghanistan who was given the chance, because it was a decision of the international community. They came together, they left together. Now, where does Afghanistan stand? What was Afghanistan's own decisive action, which they needed to take. And that is what they have been trying to say. And they have been easily trying to illustrate and say that what is the people of Afghanistan's idea? What is it that they want to take? So that is why the decision was not Afghanistan's decision. The decision which was taken was the international community's decision that they left.
Yes, okay. but after pumping in billions and billions of dollars, some of which were used productively in the country, but huge sums were siphoned off to warlords and corrupt officials, weren't they? Huge sums went missing.
I won't say that it's not true. It may be true, but who has really monitored? Where has those piles and piles and millions have really gone? Who has really seen a report which has come inside Afghanistan, and how has it gone outside Afghanistan? Where is the real proof that we have that?
Didn't you see
any
riches
system
among your colleagues in government? Didn't you see big houses, big cars? Didn't you see evidence of money that they could not have earned legitimately?
Of course I have seen. But it was not only them. There were groups who were supporting them, because within a system, and then specifically the international system, definitely there is a group like them who supports them. How do they move forward if they were not supported?
You said recently, what have we done to deserve this? What happened to Afghanistan?
Yes.
What could Afghans have done differently that might have avoided what happened to them?
To be very honest, at the very local level, at the very public level, as someone who has started from a very grassroots struggle till being a member of the cabinet, the people of Afghanistan sacrificed. The people of Afghanistan dedicated their lives, their time, their talent, their youth, their women, their girls. They could not have done far what they have done today. So that is why I had said it and I will say it. The people of Afghanistan did not deserve what happened to the people of Afghanistan. Everyone had a small little life. Everyone had a small little house. Everyone had a small little earning. Now, how much or how many or what graph of the percentage of the people of Afghanistan would have been evacuated so far? 5%? 10%? 20%? Maximum 25%. What about the rest of the 75%? Look at what disaster COVID, economical crisis, natural disasters have brought. Why had not the international community been considerate about the load of refugees? Who would like to leave their country? No one. I would never like to leave my very, very simple, simple tent, which was my own self, unless I had to, unless it was a matter of life and death, at least, or unless it was a matter of living for leaving. So the same, like so many, the people of Afghanistan could have done, have had done more than what they could. And this is what I'm saying as public.
You said recently the world has forgotten Afghanistan. You were quoted earlier as saying that. But that's not really true, is it? I mean, humanitarian agencies and the UN, already stretched, have worked tirelessly to bring whatever relief they can to the country, haven't they? But this has been one of the worst economic meltdowns in history. Did you have any idea how bad the situation was going to get economically?
I had. And that is why I said that the world has forgotten Afghanistan. And I am saying it a lot. Because it's not only a matter of humanitarian aid. Yes, I was saying humanitarian aid till the first 3 to 4 or 5 months. But it has been a year now. So what is the midterm and long-term program?
But the World Food Program has reached 18 million people, almost half the population, with food, cash, livelihood support. The organization works in all 34 provinces. and has distributed food to 800 distribution centres. That's not nothing. That's not forgetting Afghanistan, is it?
And that's not enough. That's not enough.
They do
enough.
What they can. They're
how
running out of
family,
cash, Hasina Safi.
That's how many families have they supported? I'm in contact with families who, at night, they dip the dried bread in water, and in the morning, they feed their children. So that is why I'm saying that it's not only giving them. There has to be midterm and long-term programs. And that was what we were planning, so that the country could at least take a hold on them, of themselves. The systems had been developed. Small little initiatives have been started. And today they are all stopped. So what are the people doing now? They are surviving. They are waiting still. Okay, WFP will give us biscuits. This country will give us shelter. Now, do we want all the time Afghanistan and Afghan people to be a burden on the world?
Well, let me ask you this. So far, no country has given the Taliban formal recognition because nobody seems to trust them. Should they not be recognized internationally? Wouldn't that be a start? Isn't that the minimum necessary to keep the door open with the Taliban?
For me, this is not important that Taliban are recognized or not. For me, what is important is public.
Well, let me put the question
in
a different way.
For me, what is important is that how much access do those widows who have lost, more specifically, in the last 20 years, their male members, how many families in the last 20 years do we have that they are led by female? What is that they need? What is that they need, and how can we provide that? This is what is a priority for me as a woman, and as a woman who have been a part of them and who knows their problems and difficulties.
How important is it that Afghanistan's reserves, which were frozen in the West, are unfrozen and put to use within the country? We're talking about $9 billion. 71 leading economists have said these funds are critical to the functioning of the Afghan economy. Quick question, should they give the money to the Taliban or not?
Unconditionals. Clear monitoring, mutual accountability, and last, result and impact. What is it which the public will get? We give a $9 million on the top. When you go and ask a woman in a village, when they give even $20, they have cyst piles and piles of things to ask. So what is the gap between the $90 and $20? Clear monitoring, mutual accountability, and follow-up. That is what is required.
You can't bypass the Taliban, can you? Otherwise, no aid gets through. The country director for the International Rescue Committee, Vicky Aiken, said the only solution to this crisis is to find a way to make the economy function. That requires cooperating or at least engaging with the Taliban. Is she right?
Of course, engaging with the Taliban, but we have to know, because where there is a dispute, you talk. For me, engaging is talking. Engaging is dialogue. You really have to know and talk what the knot is for. In order to open that, you have to find ways and strategies to open it. So engaging doesn't mean that you have to directly give the money, but you really have to know, how would this money be very efficiently used for the people and for the support of the people?
Not all Afghans are anti-Taliban, are they? To the extent that the Taliban has cracked down on corruption, for instance, among some groups, that's been welcomed, hasn't it? A UK Foreign Office study, which was released in July, calculated the Taliban had, as they put it, drastically reduced up to $1.4 billion in bribes given and taken every year, just on cross-border trade. They did something good, didn't they?
Of course they did something good. But where did it go now? How is it spent further? Who has that report? How has it helped people? How has it more specifically helped women? That is what I would ask next.
And that's the next priority, is it?
How does it? Of course. That is the next priority.
Hasina Safi, you're a refugee for the second time in your life. Your parents fled the Soviet invasion in the 1980s when you were a small child. You fled again with your family a year ago. How have those experiences shaped you?
More firm, more strong, and more ready to be challenging any kind of challenge which will try to demolish my nation and my identity.
What would you do differently as a politician if you were to return home?
As a politician? Yes. I was never a politician.
You were a minister. You were acting minister for
women. I was a minister because I saw that within that context, within that time frame, that was a golden opportunity for a woman to be at a decision-making and executive position, because I had advocated for the last 15 years, and that was the right time to execute all the advocacy initiatives as a women minister. And in the 1 year that I was, we had quite great achievements.
Do you see women getting to that point again?
Of course, I'm hopeful. We will have challenges, but I'm hopeful. I will never say I don't see. The day I say that I don't see, it means that is the last day of my life. I'm always hopeful.
You believe one day you'll go back to Afghanistan, don't you? What has to happen before you will make that journey? What has to change in the country before you go back?
There should be a clear foreign policy of Afghanistan for women, women participation and their participation in the development. Not only that, but the international foreign policies have to be very clear and honest and dedicated to the participation of women in Afghanistan.
Which international foreign policies? Which international foreign? Whose international foreign policies?
All the countries who have been in Afghanistan and they were supporting. Gender equality, diversity, women empowerment.
They keep talking about it.
Yes. They now need to talk the walk, to walk the talk. That is what I mean.
They can't
all
force the Taliban to change. The Taliban will change. We discussed this earlier. You think the Taliban will change, but they'll take their time over it, won't they?
They cannot change the Taliban, but they can make sure that Taliban know that this is a priority for them to move forward, because Afghanistan is a poor country. They cannot move ahead without the international community's support. So wherever it comes, they have to say this is a priority. And the definition should be given by the women of Afghanistan. We will define our role, but it's only the space. For example, in the last 20 years, as I said earlier, and again I will say, that in the last 7 years, it was a golden opportunity for the women of Afghanistan. Why? Because from a very small little space, which is a mother's name in an identity card, to a woman becoming a deputy governor in 34 provinces, which is the local politics, for the first time, the women had that opportunity. And that was in order to gather all the social and analyze all the social issues of women and connect it back with the policy and define it under the name of activity, project, program, in order to help women. Men cannot do that.
Tell me this, with all the tribal issues in Afghanistan, the different fiefdoms and warlords, the endemic corruption, is Afghanistan really governable by democratic means?
Of course, but they are more cautious. I belong to a tribal family. I belong to a grassroots family. I'm a person who was the first woman in my family who went to formal school. And there are many girls who are following me and people like me. We don't come from somewhere else. We come from Afghanistan.
Education but the leaders have always been weak, haven't they? The government has always been weak in Afghanistan.
I think politically, there has been not a clear definition of politics. As a civil society activist...
I don't know what that means.
What do you mean? It's like we do politics for people. If there is no support of politics, if there is no help, if there is no benefit of politics to people, politics doesn't mean anything.
And if people are split, what then?
People are split everywhere. It's not only in Afghanistan. Everywhere people are split. Everywhere.
So government can
work. From house to house.
You're saying government can work.
Definitely. If they are cautious, if they are considerate, if they find the very real approach to connect with people.
Hasina Safi, it's been good to have you on the program. Thank you
very much
indeed.
Thank you. Thank you very much.